It's been a long journey for the F-16. This year marks 50 years since it first took to the skies. Initially, it was a dogfighter, armed with nothing more than two sidewinders and a gun. Today, it is arguably the most versatile fighter in the US infantry. It's an air superiority fighter, an interceptor. It performs close air support, suppression of enemy air defenses, and precision bombing. Today, we will take a look back at the F-16, an aircraft which has been in the skies since the Vietnam era, and which shows no sign of retiring anytime soon. The story of the F-16 begins in the 1960s with the lightweight fighter program, which set out to find an air superiority fighter which could overcome the challenges pilots faced in Vietnam. In 1971, a team was assembled and development of the F-16 began. A variety of new aerodynamic methods were implemented, including the use of forward strakes to produce vortices over the leading edges of the wings, thus increasing lift when turning at high angles of attack. In its archaic form, the F-16 was technically an out-of-touch concept at the time, as it was conceived as a pure dogfighter. Air combat was increasingly shifting towards beyond visual range combat. Early conceptualizations had the F-16A set up as an extremely light, highly maneuverable short-range fighter, armed with two sidewinders and a cannon. Powered by the General Electric F-100, it was fast and capable of achieving speeds over Mach 2. It was an interesting idea, but the F-15 Eagle, which was also under development, was a far more promising design off the drawing board. The F-15 was agile, but also put an emphasis on longer engagement ranges, the potential for multirole missions, and it had two engines, making it a safer and more reliable aircraft in the case of technical failure. It looked like the F-15 would be the Air Force's choice, an aircraft which could supersede older designs like the F-4 Phantom, while also sticking to tried and tested methods of airframe design. Nevertheless, the F-16 team presented their design as a low-cost complement to the F-15. While the Eagle would do the heavy lifting, the F-16 could be used in various air-to-air configurations closer to the home base. Its low price also meant it posed less of an investment risk if the design failed. This approach worked, and soon the Air Force greenlit further development of three new fighter designs, the F-15 Eagle, YF-17, and the YF-16. In 1974, the aircraft would take its first flight in an unexpected takeoff during a high-speed taxi test. The deliberately unstable nature of the aircraft caused it to lift off. The pilot was forced to pull up and take the aircraft around for landing. The unexpected flight demonstrated the aircraft was keen to fly, and by 1978, the first production variants of the aircraft were entering service with the US Air Force. By the time the F-16 had begun full-scale production, many other ideas were already on the table. The F-16-79, a cheap export variant using the J-79 engine, was produced as a concept, as was a Navy testbed using the F-101 engine from the B-1A bomber. A naval variant was on the table as well, the Vought Model 1600, as well as a pre-development proposal variant. Other interesting testbeds included a forward-swept wing proposal known as SFW, and a control services tester known as YF-16-CCV. In the late 1970s, a tech demonstrator for a multirole variant was built. Known as the F-16XL, it was arguably better than anything else available at the time, and improved on most F-16 systems. For various reasons, this aircraft was never produced. In 1980, the first major upgrade program for the F-16 was started. Known as MSIP, it would have several stages. This upgrade program saw the introduction of modern multifunction displays, a better HUD, electronic countermeasures, electro-optical and target acquisition pods, BVR missile integration, and many other upgrades. By the mid-80s, with the introduction of the F-16C, the MSIP program would continue to further improve practically all internal systems. By the end of the 1980s, the F-16 had gone from being a relatively limited dogfighter to a multi-role aircraft capable of electronic warfare, suppression of enemy air defenses, air-to-ground, and beyond visual range combat. It was during this period, in 1981, that the Israeli pilots achieved the first kills for the F-16, the first against an Mi-8 helicopter, and the second against a Syrian MiG-21. That same year, Israeli F-16s aided by F-15s undertook Operation Opera, in which 8 F-16s snuck into Iraq, damaging the Otirak nuclear reactor, which was under construction. This proved that early on, the F-16 was capable of advanced air-to-ground missions. By 1987, the F-16C had been upgraded to Block 30 and 32 configurations. These aircraft would come fitted with new engines, the F-110. If the block number ended in 0, it would be a General Electric engine. If it ended in 2, it would receive a Pratt & Whitney engine. It would also be equipped with an embedded GPS INS, or EGI system, which uses global positioning data and combines it with inertial navigation data. Thanks to this, the Block 30s would also receive support for JDAM munitions. The aircraft would also see the introduction of Northrop Grumman's Lightning Targeting Pod, which is still used today. During the 1980s, the US Navy received its first batch of F-16s. These aircraft, 22 modified E-model Block 30 aircraft, were to be used at the Naval Fighter Weapons School as adversary aircraft and would be referred to as the F-16N. In 2002, they received a further 14 F-16s, this time early A and B models which possessed higher agility, also for adversarial training roles. From 1981 onwards, NASA would begin work on a technology testbed. A modified airframe was used, which soon became known as the Advanced Fighter Technology Integration, or AFTI, F-16. This aircraft was important in developing what we now know as the modern F-16. Flying from 1982 through to 2000, the aircraft chiefly underwent major modifications during the 80s. Among the many developments made during this period were a helmet-mounted queuing system, voice command control system, triplex dual flight control system, an automated target handoff system, which allowed ground controllers or other aircraft to slew targets to the F-16, and the development of the auto GCAS system, which has famously saved the lives of unconscious pilots. By 1988, another demonstrator was being finalized. Initially called the Multi-Axis Thrust Vectoring, or MATV, it was initially a joint project between General Electric and the Israel Defense Force. As the name suggested, it was a tech demo aircraft designed to test thrust vectoring. The US Air Force had initially been uninterested, so the Israelis funded the project. The deal included the Israelis handing over one of their Block 30 F-16Ds, a two-seater, to be converted. However, that same year, General Electric had received a contract funded by NASA, the US Air Force and Navy, to produce an in-flight simulator aircraft, known as Vista. In 1991, the two programs combined, and the Air Force took over from Israel and began funding research. A modified F-16D was built, and experiments were done using thrust vectoring nozzles. Later, the aircraft then took on its role as an in-flight simulator. This aircraft, now known as the X-62, is still used to this day as a trainer, technology demonstrator, and testbed aircraft. The final major variant of the F-16C to see widespread adoption was the Block 5052. This variant, which was originally introduced in 1991, has since seen many upgrades. Today, it is outfitted with a variety of modernized avionics systems and kept for the most part up to date. Many other variants of the F-16 were produced following the Block 50. Today, work is being done to produce the Block 70. These aircraft are primarily being developed for foreign customers, like Bahrain and Taiwan. For the US Air Force, the F-16 fleet will remain largely Block 40 and Block 50 aircraft. These aircraft will stay in service until roughly 2040, making the aircraft almost 70 years old at the time of their retirement. To achieve this longevity, roughly 600 of these aircraft will undergo an upgrade program. The oldest of these aircraft, early Block 40s, rolled off the production line in 1988, whilst the newest Block 50s were delivered in 2005. This upgrade program is known as the Post-Block Integration Team Project, or POBIT. Under this program, F-16s will be fitted with many new systems, including the new APG-83 Sabre radar, AN-ALQ-257 Integrated Viper Electronic Warfare Suite, ASQ-236 Dragon's Eye, AESA radar pod, and many other improvements. One potential addition is the Bright Cloud 218 Dispensable Active Decoy. This self-contained battery-powered cartridge would be dropped from an aircraft, activating and drawing missiles away from the F-16, much like an improved form of chaff. As work continues upgrading the US Air Force's Block 40 and 50 aircraft, and development continues on the latest export variants, it is clear that the F-16 has become one of the most successful jet fighters of all time. Unlike the F-15 Eagle, the F-16's longevity was not anticipated. Yet now it is almost an indispensable air asset for both the US, serving in most states' Air National Guards, and abroad in countries like Japan, Taiwan, Turkey, Israel, Indonesia, and many others. After 50 years, the F-16 remains one of the most common and capable fighter aircraft in the world and sits alongside the F-22 as the best dogfighter in the US inventory. It still has a long future, remaining in US service until 2040, and will likely continue to serve other air forces for decades beyond that.